we are looking for layout issues. Last time I did quickly show you some technology. Maybe it is one better way to show you the exact process which makes IC possible. This is taken from Hart's handout from MIT lecture series, so you can go on web and check. Basic idea in all the making an integrated circuit or a device is to allow you selective area processing. That means in certain regions I want to do a processing, rest should get masked. So the word itself suggests something has to be masked. So the process which allows that particular area which you want to protect from the next process to go through, this can be created on a glass plate like a photo plate. Normally it is a photo emulsion plates. There are other methods, metallizations can also be tried, which is what hard masks are. But those masks have already pattern on, as if like a negative of the photography film. So there will be dark areas and there will be clear areas. So this idea that the dark area can be opened or clear area can be opened decided by something what we call the resist type you use. Okay. So for example, here is a substrate and I have deposited a film in which I had to do some selective processing. So I say, okay, fine. I coat this with a photoresist, okay, something like this, and then I put a mask which has this area clear and the other areas dark. So if you look at the pattern, this is only cross section, but if you look at the pattern, it is something like this. This is dark area and this is clear areas. Clear means light can pass, no light can pass. So this is called dark field mask. The inverse can occur. This area may be clear and the windows may be dark. So it will be called clear field mask. So the mask is kept on this, it is right now kept as if it is kept distance. Normally it is touching or very close to it using what we call proximity alignments. And when I shine light, light cannot pass through black areas, only it can pass through clear areas. And if say the kind of resist I have been using is called PPR, positive photoresist. So what does essentially it means that the positive or photoresist are generally materials of resins which have a long carbon cross-linking chains. Whenever the link actually fixes itself, it's a huge circular rings and then it's called unetchable, bonding is complete. Whenever chain breaks, then you say it's etchable. So the PPR, positive photoresist, has a property that it is initially hard, that means it is completely linked. Whenever light shines, photons actually received, the links break. So whenever link will break, that area will become soft, soft means etchable. The contrast to this could also be having a negative photoresist, which says that initially it is open, that is, it's a soft resist. Whenever light shines on it, it will become hard, that means cross-linked, and therefore unetchable. So the same mask with a different resist can do two jobs. Is that clear? Or is that point clear? Just change the resist, or using the same resist, the complementary of this mask, wherever dark area there, you become make it clear. How do you make a complementary? Just take a contact print. Okay. So you have a complementary mask. So dark will become clear, clear will become dark. So that same resist can be used for either areas to be opened or closed. So if I shine light, the resist which is below this clear area, let's say it was a PPR, becomes soft. So these area PPR become soft. The darker area PPR remains hard. Hard means normally etchable in most of the etchants which we use. If I do so, then I put that wafer on the inside the etchable, what is called the developer. Like a photography, we also develop here. So you push this into developer, the resist which is soft dissolves, resist which is hard does not dissolve. Is that clear? So since this part was soft, when I put into etchant, that part got dissolved, and since these were the dark areas where light did not go through, so that remained hard. So I removed resist from this area. Now if I want to create a window in this deposited film, which is the mask area which I had decided, then I start etching now that the film etching itself can start with the resist already on the top. Resist is a hard material, it does not get etched in the etchant for this film.
So it protects
this mask itself. So these areas resist of film does not attack.
Only
which is clear area,
the etching starts for the film
and you create a window down.
And then the
rest area is already protected.
Is that clear?
And then you remove, we call strip the resist. There are etchants which finally can remove the resist. They are normally organic materials, some other day, some other time. What are the?
It
depends on the film. If it is SiO2, hydrofluoric acid is etchant for this. If it is any other metal, like for example, aluminium goes in orthophosphoric acid. So there are etchants and etchants, okay. Silicon etchants in HFHNO3 mixtures. So all chemical etchants, okay, all chemical etchants, okay. So remember, those etchants do not attack resist, and therefore, and normally it is believed, and which is what is shown here, that there is no lateral etching going on, but it will. In fact, the way it is shown, it will be lateral, but assume that lateral, this depth is not too much, so the lateral etching is smaller. But in that is called isotropic etching. Okay. We can do anisotropic etching where things go vertically down, but then we use gases which call plasma etchers. So the ions strike vertically down. Okay.
So they just etch
straight way down. So I remove the resist and I have the window of the film. Now I can say I have films at different areas, the rest films I could remove.
The converse could have been made if I would have just replaced this PPR by an NPR. These areas would have been protected, the rest area would have gone out. Okay.
So this is how lithography process goes through. When I say I mask, I do this processing.
Every time,
let's say I see CMOS process is 24 masks. 24 times wafers will see each time this some different mask and you keep etching some areas. Is that clear to you? So this is essentially the crux of
all
integrated circuit manufacture. Now the problem started, the wavelength of the light which is used typically in photolithography, that's why it's called photolithography, is typical order of
ultraviolet light
which actually allows resist to expose. 2900 to 4200 angstroms is light wavelength which we use. However, this wavelength itself, if you see lambda is very large right now, 4000 angstrom is a sufficient wavelength. So if you are reducing your feature less than the wavelength itself,
then the diffraction
and refraction both starts and the pattern cannot be exactly etched out. So that lithography will not be correct. So you will have to reduce the wavelength of the light. Okay. So from photo, we may go to electron beams which can have then higher energy and lower wavelengths.
Then the photoresist will be different.
There will be other organic material like methyl acrylate. Many other materials can be tried. If you want further lower wavelengths, you can go to X-rays. If you want further this, you can go to ions.
The larger the mass you pick up, the hit it will give to the material will be hard and material will become actually non-crystalline.
So one cannot use ion lithography very easily because it will actually damage the wafer itself.
But no one wants to really do electron beam lithography because even electrons have high energy, therefore they are lower wavelength. So they will also actually damage the silicon below.
So somehow what we do, we create the mask, this mask using electron beam lithography, which is on a normally glass plate. Okay. And use that corrected mask and use lithography like photolithography. But the problem there then is how good the patterns transfers.
So there are different ways of doing it.
And now what is the wavelength we are using is called extended UV below 193 nanometers. And there is a latest process which probably Intel will start working this year, EUV, okay, extended UVs. So these are the
things which are going on.
The other problem which technology people now getting because of 20 nanometer, 30 nanometers or less, is they are such a small this, when I actually do whatever etching, the pattern which I see has nothing to do with pattern which was on the mask.
So for example,
I may have this ma actually, but what I may get is something like this, actually. Now how do I get that area which I W bar I was looking for? Okay. So now the issues are, so do we what we do called phase masking? We do some DSP or image processing. We figure out for different patterns, if you are this pattern, what do you really get? Do I inverse transform and see if I want this, what should be the actual pattern? But creation of that is not so trivial. Then there is called projection mask alignment. There are many techniques which are tried now for going to less than 20-30 nanometers. Lithography was very simple till 1 micron. As you went down, scaling, lithography people were first hurt. So major effort therefore went in lithography process. Okay. For electron beam can directly write on the wafer. You don't need any mask, you actually wherever resist you want, you open, put light, electron beam can be very sharply focused through ACM. So I can actually write patterns on the wafer itself. But each chip will have so many transistors to write, and there will be hundreds of chips on a wafer and hundreds of wafers to be done. This is called direct stepping.
Direct write is very costly
because you know every wafer has to go through hours of printing before you, that is very accurate, but that's very expensive.
So people who have
money and who can sell the chip for $1 million can probably do that direct stepping. Otherwise, photolithography then has to be performed for the larger numbers to be created in one go. Some image processing, new techniques, mass projection printing, many tricks are being tried. Lower UVs are being tried, extended UVs as they call it, and this process is very hard. Right now, no one knows exactly what is the wavelength Intel is going to use.
The machines are made
by themselves, the resist is of their own way, and they are not right now allowing people to know what exactly this extended U will be and can they go up to 7 angstroms
or 7 nanometers.
The problem which we see in real life is essentially called the mismatch problem. We have already seen in our analysis that if beta is delta beta plus delta beta plus minus, what can occur? Okay, we have seen all such variations can create what kind of actual problems for you. So now how to alleviate some of them? Not that everything can be minimized, everything can be removed, but minimization can be tried. One technique is to get into a layout problem which probably can save some of your mismatch problems. So what first look at into mismatch? Factors causing transistor mismatch. As I said, there may be number of ways because of this it can happen. One of course is, I yesterday said there will be many transistors on a chip. Each mask will have different shifts and when you align, they will have further different shifts. At the end of the day, each chip will have different, everything different. So misalignment, then there is something called misalignment. When you fix one pattern over the other, whatever you say, it is not 100% matched. And as it goes sideways, it goes further differently. So there are issues which is mismatch issues. Now, first thing we must do, how to model that mismatch. If you can model it partly, we can take care in design. Then of course, can we control it at the process and the device level? Like threshold can be controlled to a great extent by different methods. So we try that. Then impact of transistor mismatch. One of the major worry in DRAM was, or SRAM was, the sense amplifier design. And there the mismatch created a hell of this 1-0 was never guaranteed then. And we are looking fast excesses. So there is first time people realize that this mismatch can create huge problem in the reliability of a DRAM. Of course, one possible technique is to control at the circuit level. So you know how much is offset you have, you try to cancel as much as possible. If it is a systematic offset, what is systematic? Go in one direction. So here is something which looks trivial. The way transistor works, you have a diffusion area. Of course, there is no color, four colors here, but maybe blue I call it red, black I call it green. This is red and this is green. So normally what is done is first poly is printed, etched out. And then implants have been done at the edge of poly. So this becomes N plus or P plus, whichever transistor you are making. And this also becomes N plus. But below there is an oxide. Below all polys will be a thin oxide gate. Okay. So since this is the area, where gate outside below is available. So this is the channel length and this is the channel width. So fixing this diffusion area or source drain area and the poly width decide the W by L of any transistor. So whenever I show you a green line intersecting red, there is a transistor below, wherever is the common area. Okay. So it's called G intersection R. So here is that G intersection R shown. This is diffusion or N plus, and this is poly, which also will receive N plus when I am doing this implants. Now you tend to see three are almost identical as far as if you see the pattern, that's it. But in real life, the color shows that somewhere diffusion is larger, some is smaller, some is shifted left or small is shifted right. That is not visible so much from the pattern itself. Okay. But in reality, the process down has created the shifts. Okay. Because as I say, lithography process is never guaranteed process. Okay. Now these three structures after IC processing are not identical to each, and therefore these are so close by to each other and still they are not identical. If you are far away, unlikely that all will be of same value. Okay. And how much you can tolerate is your design spec. This is called some other process, a halo, but let's call it. There is an intrinsic factors which is causing the mismatch, which is called discrete dopant effect. Then there is the interface state fluctuations. Extrinsic, because of the process, there is a random variation in gate length, gate widths, outside thickness, implant dose, implant energy, anneal temperature, gate and source drain overlap, and spacer thickness. Spacer generally comes in the case of FinFETs. Okay. So there are many variations going on. Okay. These are called process variations. Designers must take care of process variations. These are statistical in nature. So some statistical analysis should be actually attempted. That's what we do sometimes. One of my PhD students worked for this process. How to correlate process variation with circuit performance. Okay, as you reduce the channel, let's say the concentration because of the VT which you are adjusting is such that the volume there, let's say 10 to the power 15 for sake of numbers, the channel length is less than 10 to the power minus 5 centimeters. 0.1 micron or lower. So what is the volume? 10 to the power minus 15. If it is lower, it will be 10 to the power minus 16, 17 per cc. So what is the number of carriers there? Less than 1. Okay. So one cannot guaranteedly say where is the electron, where is the carrier. Okay. So there is an issue which is called dopant effect. Okay. Random dopant effect. It will affect the off current. It will affect the on current, that is the saturation current. It will affect the thresholds. It will affect the sub-threshold slopes. And it will affect the transconductance and all RCs and any other parasitics which are area dependent and dopant dependent will also get variations. So if you see a device parameters which worries you most at the circuits, because of the process variations, all will be moving from one. And please remember, our worry is on-chip variation, chip-to-chip variation, wafer-to-wafer variation, and run-to-run variation. Run means 200 one run, next 200 run. So run-to-run variation. So huge problems. Okay. We do everything fantastic. We say everything is controlled. At the end, we see all variations. So if you look at the impact of process parameters on circuit, yeah, already I said current, capacitance, threshold, variation in threshold. So they may change speed,
dynamic power,
static power, and the worst is the yield. It will actually reduce the, what is yield? I decide this is the minimum specs I will expect. Okay. Anything goes beyond that, that chip is not up to the mark. So that chip is wasted. So we say yield. So the at the end, if you find your yield going below 50%, the whole process is of no use. Okay. This statement is very interesting that there is, it seems as if there is a direct relationship, but there is a non-linear relationship because all the expressions are non-linear at the end of the day. So it is very difficult to actually predict which one will hurt you most and when. Okay. And that is the analysis someone has to do, is called statistical analysis. Of course, as I say, some of them are correlatable, some are uncorrelated processes, and then it's much difficult to actually predict things. Okay. I will not go into detail of statistics. This is an area of our students' PhD work. Just to give an idea, if threshold varies, and there is a variance which is different for different processes, sigma of delta Vt. If you see this term, and I have taken an example of ADC. ADC is one of the major device in the analog to digital converters, which are most mixed signal, most important chip or circuit. So if you see, if I have a 7-bit ADC, the sigma allowed to me is around 5 to 6. Okay. Anything below, let's say 5, yield is okay. But if you look at the 10-bit ADC, even a half a millivolt shift of sigma, the yield may go down, okay, zero. So the decision of making, even in this was done only for 0.25 micron process. If you do other further down, God knows what will happen if 12-bit or 16-bit ADCs are used somewhere. So the precision and mismatch are very, very crucial in analog designs. As one example I am showing you, this is how the sample hold actually changes the equivalence of analog to digital. So 1001 pattern may become 10111 kind of thing, and which will not be representing the actual digital data for the analog. Okay. So there are issues which essentially process people know that at the end nothing will come, and therefore layouts become extremely, this is all just to tell you all that why layouts are so crucial at the end of the day, and layouts are the only thing which as a designer we create, the W by L, sizing. And then when you lay it out, things may work or may not work if you haven't taken enough precautions on that. Okay. As I say, basic layout design techniques should be taught by Professor Madhav Desai's course. That's the issue where digital designers should learn more about that. This course has no such area left in my course where we say layout design. Otherwise, layout editors is a part of any design process. Okay, so is that point clear? Why I am worried about mismatch so much? Because money, economics is worrying. 10 bit, no yield, then what do we do? We made so many of them and there is none working well. So that is the issue which companies like National, TI, everyone is worried about, who sell ADC chips, okay, or analog. Is that okay? The issue is clear to you, why mismatch is real worrying. So there are issues in layout. One is called orient, we'll come one by one. Whatever is now following, figures have been taken from Razavi. There is a chapter on this mismatch. Word itself is mismatched there. So look for that chapter and I'll show you what is the worry there. The issues of orientation of layout, symmetry, adding dummy layers, unit cell repetitions, and the last but not the least, the last but one is most important, called common centroids and avoiding interconnect resistance. These are the issues which as a layout designers you must be. By the way, in design, when you design a chip, till you make the, before the metal mask comes, the process is called front end. That is, designers, W buyers have gone in, okay. So it's called front end. The rest of the process to make interconnects, back end, whatever, and this, all issues related to this, these are called back end processes. These are torturous, boring, but they are paid higher than front end engineers. Okay, because the testing is the last part which they come to it, and there is where they start looking things worse happening. Okay, so here is something typical. This is shown to you. There are two devices shown here. One can see from here, this is the poly, that is, this is the gate which is shown here. Okay, this is a P plus implant, this is an N plus implant. And one can see, right now it's only one transistor shown, the other part I have not shown. This contact is essentially called metal 1. There are more than one metal possible. Each metal is separated by oxide on the top. So what we did is, for this P plus implant for source drain we did here, what we now did that opened a contact to the gate, to the source and to the drain.
Okay.
So this is essentially called active regions. And this, and the any, so the method is any metal 1 normally runs vertical, any metal 2 runs horizontal. Normally they are not running in the same direction or no angles. Layout should never be at 45 degree or 30 degree. Parallel coordinate, normal XY system is always used. These lines are called Manhattan lines.
Why?
Okay, some of you might have visited USA. New York, Manhattan has avenues and streets. Exactly, Santa Cruz, if you go somewhere in Mumbai, avenues and streets. Okay. Actually, we copied from there. So, Manhattan has all roads like this and all streets like this. So, this is called Manhattan lines. Okay. So, the way right now you can see, there are different directions I am taking metal out. Okay. And that is not acceptable to me. Okay, because if I do this process for n number of times, it will show you much more variations on this, unless I am symmetric to something. Okay, so I'll show you what symmetry will show. So this kind of interconnects are not treated well, where you pick up connection anywhere, anytime, and run anywhere, anytime. It is not a good way of putting your layouts. Okay. This is given in Razavi's book, specifically written. So you don't draw it. Can look into figure there. The another issue which is called antenna effect, and one can see this is a normal transistor. These are two devices shown here, for example, polys. Please remember these are two transistors in series. Do you see them? Source, drain,
source.
So drain of the two are same, but it is only a matter of decision to say, because they are symmetric, this also we count source drain. So you say connect source and drain in between, or call drain or both together, whichever way you feel like, as long as the devices are
symmetric.
There are other devices called asymmetric. Those devices like LDDs and others, they do not have source same as drain. So don't connect like that. Now what we do is, though they look to be in series, essentially what does two transistors in series means equivalently of a one transistor? What does they show?
Two transistors,
okay, before we go to there, maybe a simple figure can explain you.
This is one possibility, same connection, second
is, this equivalent of what, and this equivalent of what? In this case, the lengths are doubled. Widths are same, or whatever you said. In this case, widths are double and lengths are same. So transistor sizing, whichever you come, normally do not put huge size transistors. Break into either series or parallel combinations so that the uniformity of each probably is much more maintainable. There is a word which we use in layout which is called aspect ratio. What is the word aspect ratio? Let us say this is the line
length.
This is small, much smaller compared to this.
So whenever I do
etching, I cannot guarantee etching here to here same, because I am going through a huge length. Okay. So the length here may not be same as length here. This is called aspect ratio issue. So don't run too long lengths. Break into as many as you want. Either using, if you want W to be higher or length to be higher, use either of the methods to actually break into
smaller number of devices,
large number of devices, to equivalently putting. For digital people, those who are doing digital course, this also has an advantage.
This is called gate stacking.
Socho kya kar rahe hai? Ye bahut hi important hai low power karne ke liye. Socho fir kabhi. This is one of the most important technique of reducing power in a digital circuit. Okay. So now what we did, this is a similar transistor shown here. So one method was that, okay, you connect common gate together and put one big metal. There is a
suggestion that if you have a single metal layer connecting to the contacts here and you run it longer as we did here, it gives like a some kind of a resonator circuit on a oxide. In any insulator, if you run a metal line, it acts like an antenna, okay, it's a radiating system. This is what we do in MICs. Instead of there in aluminum substrate or other substrate, you have silicon dioxide substrates. So it runs like an antenna, so it radiates power. So much of the, if you calculate the pointing vector here, the huge power loss is at this end. Okay. So to divide this, we say, okay, the metal one where the contact is coming, which is the dissimilar discontinuity as we say, you make it that small and run another metal on the top through oxide through a window to that, which will actually take care of those contacts away from the actual this, so that the radiating patterns will be restricted only here, which has a smaller power loss. This is called antenna effect. Okay. So we aapko ye bata rahe hain ki designers kya kya sochna padta hai. If you learn like this, yeah, in some frequency it may still work, but higher the frequency you go, this will be one which will say there is the radiation is much more than the power delivered to you. Okay, so these are issues. Another issue which I just show random this connection. So one method is, for example, this is called surrounding. You can see here, what did I do? There I have a two gates. So here also I have a two gates, fingers, these are called fingers, common point here. And the drain contact is taken in between. This is drain and this is source, is that clear? Source on the outside and center is the drain. So I took drain here, source outside, and connected them also. Okay. This is still a single transistor. Please remember, sources are common, drains are also connected. So what does it mean? It's parallel transistors, two are connected here. Is that clear to you? This is essentially how it's called folding or finger structures. Okay. You can do larger numbers. If you have large number of W by S to be connected, put equivalently this, sources on the top, drains on the up, or what you, opposite. Call source drains are same. So whichever is source, whichever is drain, and in between run polys like this, zigzag. So you can make, can you now see these structures are more symmetric? You take symmetry across this, or you take symmetry across this. Okay. So there is a symmetric structures can be created by actually folding them. Okay. Fold properly as much as you can, and then see to it that symmetry is some way attained. Okay. This is called multi-finger transistors. Okay. The same statement which I made, if you have a very large size transistor wide, you can have two sets of them and in between connect, okay, multi fingers, and then connect together. Okay. So there are larger the size tricks to be, again you can see from here it is trying to get into more symmetric systems. Our ultimate aim is getting symmetric systems. Why I am looking for symmetry, anyone? Because whatever processing I will do, if all sides is similar, then they are likely to duplicate everywhere the same. Aspect ratio issue will never come into picture. Okay. So larger the fingers I create, more likely I will get symmetric structures, and more symmetry means much more uniformity of etching if lithography is possible. Okay. Please don't draw because it takes hell of time, and these figures are available just to explain you what is going on. Maybe I will put it on the web if you wish. The differential pair, which is the most common circuit you will use, you can see from here, one method is you have one device here, you have another device here. Now you can see I have one poly, that is one input gate is like this, but the other is I made like this. Now it is not symmetric. The source I have made common. One drain is going, but the other drain is away from each other, like this. These lengths are different than this length for the contacts. Okay. So what should I do then? I should either do this or I should do this. Now you can see identical drains, identical source. So if you take
symmetry across this. DFAM has a symmetry, that's what we have been all the time feeling, DFAM has a symmetry requirement. So if you lay it out, only then the DFAM symmetry is easily accessible to you. In this, you can break more devices if you wish, but fold it, now this is called folded symmetry, do like this and again do the, but again it is symmetric. Symmetry is all that I am looking for any lithography process, okay, and therefore any layout I make has much more worry in symmetry points. Okay. Is that okay? There is another worry which analog people gets problems into. Here another problem which we observe is called, like when I was making the n-channel device, I have this oxide and gate delineated first and then implant through drain. But it is the way implantation process goes. Many of you might not be aware, those who are doing technology course in our other, they might have seen already implants. There is a columnar tube, maybe of any size of 8 inch or 12 inch, through which electron beams, ion beams of particular dopant or water implant you are doing is actually getting focused by electromagnetic fields. Okay. When it comes as a focus beam, the wafer is orthogonal to it. Okay. But the distance when the focusing is done by lens, electromagnetic lenses, the wafer is does not have exact angle of 90 degree. You have to keep it at least 3 to 5 degree off some other day. It is a part of requirement for good implants. Now if I have an angle, this will get lesser, this will get higher because focusing here will not be there. This is going to happen. So I will tilt the beam anyway. 3 degree beam at least I will shift, maybe 5. So I will not actually have 90 degree orthogonal beams. Okay. Further, I will have to scan them. So when I scan them, it is like normally rasters are scanned, but some people do vector also. So when I flash back, there is a residual implant comes. Okay. So when you come back to original position, there is a residual system. So on the left and the right, you do not get identical implants. The reason is, you can now see this n plus and this n plus are, look you see here it is very internally very small, here internally it is larger. Larger the inside part essentially means capacitance is increasing. Okay, this is called drain capacitance. What is the problem with drain capacitance increase? Your pole actually will move. Okay, it may become dominant which wasn't there. Okay. So what we do now in this, this is two possible structures which are there. So we do something very interesting. You have these two transistors to make. You actually put another two transistors. Okay. So now this transistor on its left sees another transistor. This transistor already sees another transistor. This also sees another transistor. If I take it away, this side is different from this side in between. So what I say is, to create a symmetry, I actually create dummy transistors on the left side or right side. Okay. So it's called bias. So whatever bias I see on the one side, I see exactly identical on the other side. These are called dummy transistors. At least if not put transistors, at least put poly lines. This poly to this poly, because there where the implant edge comes. So the minimum requirement in analog is every transistors, if they are not together, they must be surrounded by parallel poly lines to create symmetry for implants. Is that correct? Yes. You can see from here, if I have a large beam coming, if I don't have this, there is a energy going other side. If I have back here, I have energy only equivalently on both sides. Okay, so to keep energy distribution of the implant same on source drain side, I must have valves at both sides. Okay, these are essentially valves for that. Okay, dummies as they, and they are not being connected anywhere. These are dummies. If you put transistor, you have area, put transistor itself. If you don't have area, at least put poly lines everywhere to protect your internal parts. Is that clear? So these if you see analog, this is what is needed. In digital, why we are not interested so much? Because noise margins are sufficiently high. Any such things goes there, it will probably take care at the end of the day. There is no margin here. Anything goes wrong, amplified. Okay. So that is very in analog. This word symmetry, you can see from here there are two transistors and I am connecting a metal something like this, but no connection on this side. Okay. So don't do this. Okay. You do metal 1 and metal 2, and if you feel this is not needed, don't connect it anywhere.
Is that clear?
If M2s are not needed, don't run it anywhere, but near transistors, keep them. Okay. So any time you do on the left, useful. Even if it is not required, put same thing on the right to be have symmetry structures. Now I must tell you what is my worry with this. This is the next one which I will do as a circuit this, maybe you will get this figure. This is also one matching problem. If one is vertical poly, here is horizontal poly, never do the same, run always
same direction.
If you have this, all of them should be horizontal or all of them should be vertical. Of course, preferably do everywhere the same, but other cell you may do change also if you need connections the other side.
So, but in the small area, whichever cell area you are creating, symmetry has to be 100% maintained.
This is called orientation effect. There is something which Rezavi talks, but then I will give some maths behind. What we say from left to right, there is some variation called gradient
of the sizing, for example.
Okay. Because of the process, whatever I do, actually there is a gradient in the process. Okay. Now what it can create, here is an example which I'll show you.
Assuming right now
linear gradient. Linear gradient means
it's much easier in
real life, it may not be even linear gradient. Let us say the size of a pattern is twice, this is equal, you know, so slightly
equal to
twice the size of B. And let's say there is a gradient on the left to right, linear gradient. So when actually I will print this, this will not remain double that of B. Is that correct? This is essentially worrying us most, because then we decided two areas to be double, one or double out of this, but in gradient, this will not allow this to happen. So what we did is some interesting feature. Of course, there are many other transistor should have, area should have been shown, but I just chose for one. Let us say the gradient is y is equal to mx plus c, linear gradient. Okay. For A1, let us say A is broken into two areas,
A1 and
A2. So I write A1 is mx1, this is for A1, mx1 plus b, b is the intercept, A2 is mx2 plus b, and b is mx3
for this
plus b. Okay. Now, if I write A1 plus A2 by b, I get mx1 plus x2 plus 2b by this. However, this does not become twice unless this becomes 2. Now, this can only become 2 when the x3 is equal to x1 plus x2 by 2. Okay. Now, this is an issue. Okay. This is an issue. X1 plus x2 must be, average of that must be equal to x3. Now this problem which we see, if x3 is not x1 plus x2 by 2, a1 plus a2 by b2 is not equal to 2 either. Okay.
So what we now do,
we say okay, put x1 minus x2 and x2 minus x3 same, or essentially saying x2 should be x1 plus x3 by 2. If I do this, x1 plus x3 by 2 and put b here, okay.
A1, A2 is
across this, similarly A2 should come on the other side and A again.
So this is called common centroid,
okay. This is called common centroid. So if you have a circuit broken into a parts, I don't know whether I have a figure, but I'll show you what it shows. There may be blocks here
along this axis,
along this axis, it is identical. Okay. So let's say there is a variation from, this is A1, B, for example, variation here, opposite will appear here.
If I connect them,
then variation in the two is getting cancelled. Is that clear? So I do always common centroid net, breaking into blocks, so that the effectiveness of variation can be cancelled or at least minimized. So all analog designers should make their layout common centroid. So 4 W by L ka hai, to do do ke aise rakho. So that. So in DFAM also you have two transistors, so M1, M2, M2, M1 by 2, M2 by 2, M2 by 2, M1 by 2. Now you can see it is common to all four sides and therefore it will show minimum gradient effect. Okay. This is an issue which is called layout issue, which if you don't take care, then the problem will be the sizes of what you actually were creating are not getting
transferred.
Is that clear? So one difference from digital hardware analog is, every layout in analog is common centroid. Okay, that gives the maximum symmetry. At least, if not that, do some symmetry at least. Preferably use common centroid, but at least symmetry you create minimum, that is what is expected. Now here is something very interesting data which is given by, not data, calculations given by Razavi.
Same thing can
be explained from here. You have four transistors, M1, M2, M3, M4.
Let us say due to the gradient,
it has an oxide capacitance of Cox. It is
Cox plus delta
Cox, Cox plus two delta Cox. This is Cox plus three delta Cox. So one possible technique is you connect these two and you connect these two. So what is the capacitance you are going to get? Ox 1 plus, there is no 3, so 2 Cox plus 3 Cox, delta Cox, here 2 Cox plus 3 delta. You do this way, you connect this and this, and you connect this and this. Then Cox, 2 Cox plus 2 there, 2 Cox plus this. So essentially, of course, this becomes 4. So depending on how much symmetry you are, gradient you are expecting, you must decide which transistor should get gate connections, which transistor should not, which should be closer by. So don't put connection at least this. This is the worst connection. This is 2 Cox plus, and this is 5 delta Cox it will come. So either try this or try at least this, so that you get symmetry as close as possible, which is created due to gradient in the process.
Is that clear?
So now all that I am trying to show you, that why in analog layouts it is little different from, so Virtuoso, which is the famous layout editor in the case of Cadence, if you see analog designer, there is a separate shell in which you work. If you are a digital designer, you work in a different shell. The reason is this layout, both have Virtuoso, but they are different Virtuosos. Okay, so it's actually designed for analog, the other is designed only for digital hardware. Okay, so please use it, don't use magic, because magic is, it has no connection with anything, neither analog nor digital, it is only a graphic editor. Okay, so there you can do anything you like physically by forcing it. In real life, we are not allowed to force ourselves.
System will actually tell you are going wrong.
But you are always possible to overrule it. This is allowed. Okay, and but if you do that, you are taking a big risk on yourself. Okay, the circuit which I showed you earlier, I should have showed now, this is called common centroid. Is it clear?
Half
M1, half M2, half M1. You can even flip this. Okay, even better.
Sab jagah symmetry banai hai.
So this is called common centroid. Ye centroid hai uska.
Iske charo taraf
similar aana chahiye. Symmetry aana chahiye. ऐसा ब्रेक करिए. ओके, द लास्ट पार्ट ऑफ दिस वी हैव ओनली सीन ट्रांजिस्टर सो फार. इन एनालॉग व्हाट एल्स यू नीड?
रेजिस्टर्स
एंड कैपेसिटर. ऑफ कोर्स वी आल्सो नीड इंडक्टर्स, बट दिस कोर्स वी विल नॉट टॉक अबाउट देम.
Here is the resistor.
This you can draw. This is not a very big circuit. You can see from here, these RS and RD are not the transistor resistors I put. These are essentially the resistors which is
source drain area resistors.
Actually, I should also put RG in case if you need. Okay. So how do I do this?
If I have
an N-well device,
area there.
I yesterday said you start with a P substrate and create a deep area, which is called N well. Well means 5 micron down or 3 micron down. That's why I call well. Please remember, in circuit, only first half a micron or even lower is the actual surface area you will use,
surface depth
you will use.
All devices
are within 5000 angstroms. Okay.
Then you don't need further.
Then why do you need so much thickness of silicon? Because it's extremely fragile, and to handle it, at least you should have some stability.
So for 12-inch
wafer, you can now understand why it should be very relatively much thicker, because 12-inch wafer will huge mass and it may just break jocularly by seeing. Okay.
So you must actually put some this so that it holds.
So typically 1.5 millimeter to 2 millimeter thickness wafers are used for 12-inch. For 3-inch wafers, 250 microns are sufficient thickness. But the device is going to be within less than a micron. But the wells are normally slightly below this.
Is that correct?
Because device has to have substrate kind of effect for source and drain. So the wells are typically 2 to 3 microns. Old time we used to make it 5 microns. So if in an N well, if I make N plus contacts,
N well would have
some resistive sheet resistance, rho by T. So RS is known. This is my length. There is a width in the inside this. So L by W into RS is the resistor value. So adjusting this and adjusting the second width of that, I can decide how much is the resistance I want. This, since it is a P substrate, this is a NP junction.
So there is a depletion
layer going on. Is that clear? This depletion layer
should not connect.
Okay.
This is called punch through.
The two resistors will get connected. Okay. So there is a rule up to which two resistors could be brought together. Okay. Normally resistors are created due to the implant areas available to you. So which are the areas available? Substrate,
N plus implant,
P plus implant, the on wells. So there are four RS available to you, depending on the
substrate at the highest,
lowest concentration, highest resistivity. So if you just take on a substrate to
a gardening,
you create and put a contact there, you can create large resistors.
Okay.
But normally not used. Whenever you need large resistor, which way you use?
You actually
create transistors in saturation region, and you have large amount of R can be created.
The last part
of this circuit is capacitances. You can see from here a capacitance. Okay, I just told you last time, maybe before I go, there are number of, maybe we should use a fresh sheet.
Let's say
this is my first layer. I am making an n-channel device. I open a contact. There is a gate here. There is a poly here.
These are all oxides. These are contacts. This is the first metal
I took for source drain, and gate of course is in the vertically outside. So I put another oxide on the top. Okay. Then if I want a contact with this, I open a window in this oxide and run the metal from the top, which then will get contact to the lower end. If I want a contact to this metal, I put another oxide on that and open a window here, where this next metal actually gets connected to the next metal. at no time this can directly be connected to the lower down. You must connect to the next nearest metal layer. Okay. The catch is, whenever you open a window here, there should not be another window below. Okay. Because the processes will then maybe intermerging somewhere. So if you open a contact here, open somewhere here, the next contact on the next layer. All contacts should never match each other. They should be at separated positions. Okay. But you still go down and connect. Is that correct? These are called metal 1, metal 2, metal 3, metal 4, metal 5, metal 6, metal 7, and we are now going up to metal 9. Okay. Why we need large numbers?
Because many of the
processors or DSP in particular, you need huge interconnect lines going from one place to the other.
So our metal lines are similar, we can go as many metals.
Of course, there is an issue, why not beyond 9, why not 100? Oh, so the problem starts that the total resistance for the length of interconnect you go through will be so high that the voltage will drop there itself, nothing will go down. Okay. So there is a length minimum you can, you have to restrict to. So in capacitors, normally between two metal layers, there is an insulator. So there is a capacitor, wherever you make two contacts, there will be a capacitance associated. But the way we actually do the capacitances in our this is the following. You have this process of transistor, but let's say in the top, first poly line has been created for the gate, poly one. Of course, all poly will be protected below by oxides. Then, sorry, this poly I should use this. Then there is another oxide layer on this poly I created, and I put another poly here.
This is called poly 2.
It's called double poly process. Not all processes are double poly. All flash processes, flash ROMs are, they all are double polys. But not all CMOS processes are double poly. But analog CMOS processes are always double poly. So extra money for that. Okay. So this is poly oxide poly. So that is the most common capacitor used in analog designs,
created in analogs.
If you don't have one, there is another way of doing the same thing which I was showing you. Instead of calling this poly, this is called metal 1. And this is metal 2
or 3 or 4. So restrict the
area of metal. So you have a capacitor down, which is called MIM capacitors, which are called MIM capacitors. Please remember, once I use this line, I must break it somewhere, because otherwise there will be one line everywhere. So the area for each has to be restricted to make a standard area of capacitor. Is that clear? So restrictive area will make standard epsilon A by D kind of thing. So either MIM capacitors are used, or poly, if you have two poly process, poly 2 to poly 1 is what is used often in our processes. Most people have poly 2. If they don't have, then you use only MIM. Digital process will have MIM, because there are 7 layers available or 9 layers available. Now there also it is decided the capacitor should be closest to the point where the node capacitance is to be created. Otherwise, for us, parasitic capacitance will actually shift our poles, okay, or zeros. So in analog, the position of capacitance to choose has to be which node you are actually looking at. So closest to that you actually bring your capacitances. Instead of having a large capacitors, you can actually create small capacitors of C1 and then connect in a fashion. But do you see this capacitance is not connected to anywhere? These are connected 6, 6, 2. So 8 capacitances are connected to give 8. Let's say this has a capacitance of 1 or C. This is 8C.
Is that clear?
This is C, and this all are in parallel made, so they are 8C. Where do you think such things are needed? In a switch cap circuits, you actually will use two such capacitances.
This will be 8 times this,
okay. So if you want to do this circuit, use this kind. You make a round, Now, all that I have not shown, and even Rivari has not shown, you need dummy everywhere. All areas must be put dummies all around. So, 8 of them and further 8 of them around, just to keep them identical to each other. Is that clear to you? So, this is something not shown, but please remember, every dish has side should have equivalent dummies, top, bottom, side, everywhere. So, this is nip, but then you should have here, here, at least poly, as I say, here, here, everywhere. Okay. This is essentially, it's called 8:1 capacitance ratio. This circuit is creating 8:1 capacitance ratio. 8 from this, 1 from here. Okay. Change this combination and you can create any other ratio as well. The last slide for the day as well as for this layout part is this. Interconnect routing. Now this is an issue which is available, it is equally troublesome in digital but shown only for analog here. Let us say you have a current mirror which is mirroring so many of them. Like you have now M6, M6, M5, M so much even in op amps. Okay. Now whatever way I use this line which is called the ground line, okay, or VSS line, one can see from here, between here to here, there has to be some metal line running and it doesn't have zero resistivity, okay, it has a finite resistivity. So equivalently saying, from here to here, there is a resistor, from here to here, there is a resistor, and if this is taken little longer, so this potential will be different from this potential when the current is sinking through. Is that correct? These are sinks. So when all of them are sinking because of the mirrors, this sink will be different from this sink. Is that correct? Because the available current to you is now, the voltage drop is actually created across. Okay. This is called ground bus resistance problem. In the case of digital, even if there is no mirror, because of this we receive what we call ground bounce. The actual zero shifts to a higher potential. So your noise margin on zero become worse, sometimes even not there. Okay. So it's called ground bounce. Similarly, it comes from the power supply side, it's called power droop. So it comes down and your upper noise margin also can go. Okay. So these are issues which layout people. So what should I do for R to be minimized? Increase the area. So thickness of this metal, analog grounds are therefore at least 8 times that of digital grounds, thickness wise, at least 8 times. So if you see analog ground, huge plates kind of grounds are provided so that the R's are as small as possible. Is that clear? That is the trick. But what is the penalty? Area you lose, but at least survive, otherwise you don't survive. Okay, so that's the issue in the case of layouts. Okay. Also, now I will say, you don't use single references. Okay. Even if it doesn't matter if you run through as far as circuit things, but run another circuit ahead, another mirror and run ahead. Okay. So break into number of references in case you feel too many such things you are running from one point. So don't run from one point. This is also done in digital. Keep buffering or actually putting VDD lines on 4 places. If you see a normal chip, there will be at least 4 VDD contact and 4 VSS contact. Okay. Though you need only 1 VDD and 1 VSS, but the distance from each of them may be different. So at least 4 corners, you create 4 VDDs, same way 4 VSS. Okay. This is done even in, so jitna you think you can tolerate, keep as many, then repeat again. That extra area, but saving your life further. Okay. So these, are you now clear to you that why I spend time in analog layout? Is the issue is that things can fail at the end just because you were not aware or you were lax in layouts. Okay. Things will finally yield may show you zero. Okay. So all analog designers must spend their 50% time after so-called the simulation results have come in actually getting the best layout. Okay. Try any number of times, extract it and put it everywhere, values for them and see where it still works for you. Okay. Increase the ICMRs, decrease the ICMRs, swing rate, power supply 5% to 10%, where you keep seeing that everywhere circuit is all bounds, it actually works. Increase temperature from minus 25 degree centigrade to 125 degree centigrade, run whether all corners it works. Then keep modifying your layouts till you find most of the corners are met. So that requires hell of an effort. Okay. Most of our student copy from the last year thesis, because he must have seen some, and no one has seen in the first. So the worst things are going on last 10 years. Okay. Okay, so this finishes much of the issues on layout. There are many more things I can tell, but forget this. We'll start with next Wednesday, the last topic of this, which is called oscillators. We have done a lot of amplifiers, at least see oscillators. Actually, oscillators are not just the VCOs which we are interested in. We must do something called PLLs, phase loop locks. But I think in next 3 hours, 4 hours, I don't think I will be able to catch up with PLLs, but I will at least tell you how PLL works on Friday. So on Wednesday, I may show you VCOs. On Friday, I may show you how PLL picks up, why PLLs are essential with VCOs.